Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Welcome to the Legislative Report. Today we're going to talk about Medicaid fraud, what the state can do about it, and a hearing we just had. Our guest today is Kate Hogan, who is the DA of Warren County and head of the New York State District Attorneys Association. And she came to testify and tell us a little bit about what one county can do very well to deal with Medicaid fraud. And she was joined at the hearing with Kathleen Rice, our DA in Nassau County, couple of county executives, a couple of people who do work with computers and automation that can curtail Medicaid fraud. And so the whole thing today was, we have the biggest expenditure going in the state, $52 billion a year, $1 billion a week, and you are working at this in Warren County, Ms. District Attorney, and tell me a little bit about how you approach that that challenge.
One of the things that came out of the hearing that surprised me was hearing that we spend more than Texas and California combined. So clearly there's something that we're not doing right in terms of managing our Medicaid system. We want to make sure that we're getting monies to people who need it. But what I see as a district attorney in a small rural county upstate is a system that's fraught with fraud. And what we were able to do on a local level is the sheriff, the commissioner of social services, the director of probation, and I met. And we talked about how can we work in collaboration, complying with the state rules about what information you can share and can't share to eradicate the abuse that we see. And there's some things that you can do on a local level that have been proved to be very effective in Warren County. When we started, we determined that there wasn't enough oversight. So we received authority from the Board of Supervisors to hire a part-time investigator. That investigator saved us almost $500,000 in temporary assistance in a year because he determined that 33 people that we were housing, of the 33 people we were housing, only 9 were eligible for being housed. And that's a cost of $9,600 a week. So the numbers that we're talking about add up very quickly. So what might seem like a little fraud, if you put it in the context of the money that's attended to that fraud and extrapolate it over a year, it explains why we have twice what we have both California and Texas combined.
Well, I find your background, you're not just, your Warren County has Lake Georgia in it.
Absolutely, and we want everyone in Nassau County.
And
to
you
come.
Don't, you just don't chase down people stealing speeding boats and all that. You started out as in the attorney in the DA's office in Brooklyn, which is one of the tougher ones in the entire state.
A great training ground. I worked in the Brooklyn DA's office. I worked with Kathleen Rice. She's a good friend of mine. But my husband, who was another Brooklyn DA, and I wanted to move home to my home county and raise a family, and that's what we've done. What's troubling is that. When I left Brooklyn, I never thought I'd see defendants with rap sheets from the 6-7 precinct in Brooklyn, and yet I am. I'm seeing defendants who are migrating north carrying crack and heroin because it's basic economics, supply and demand. When they go to an area, a rural area, where there isn't as much supply, they can get more money for it.
And I find what you're seeing is exactly what detectives have told me they're seeing in Nassau County, this interrelationship of a Medicaid fraud, a drug dealer, taking advantage of the welfare system.
Well, Senator, as you know, the way I really stumbled upon the extent of the Medicaid fraud in our county was through monthly narcotics meetings. And what I wanted to do was make sure that we were strategic in targeting our narcotics investigations. So the first thing I said to the narcotics investigators at our very first meeting is, these addicts are unemployed. How are they getting the money to buy the drugs? And what they told me blew my mind. They said, well, they have a benefits card, and they go to the ATM, and they get money out of it. I said, are you kidding me? So I'm paying for their drugs? You're paying for their drugs? Now, that's a simple fix. That's a computer tech writing the program that you don't even have to replace the benefits card. You just have to eliminate the opportunity to get cash for it. And no one can say that they're being denied what they're entitled to because they're entitled to have housing paid for or they're entitled to have food. No one is entitled to have taxpayers pay for their crack or heroin. That's just not part of the deal. So that is, you know, one of those common sense, easy fixes that we scratch our head and say, why isn't someone doing this? And that's why we're grateful for your task force.
Now, the other part of it was that you talked about is the need for limiting people who are getting some drug benefits under Medicaid to have one pharmacy to get those. And I think this is another universal problem, even in counties that may have Medicaid managed care.
What's interesting, and the more you get into this, the more you realize how elaborate the rules are and how many different programs there are. First of all, I think we need to streamline the programs. I think we need to simplify the whole system. In the managed care system, people have one choice for doctor and one choice for pharmacy. In the Medicaid system, they have unfettered choices for both doctors and pharmacies, which proves very problematic for people who want to feign pain and get Oxycontin and hydrocortisone, synthetic heroin, and sell it for a profit. What they're doing is they're doctor shopping, and they're going around to multiple doctors. Now, pain is a subjective claim, and so I'm not trying to impugn the integrity of all doctors, although some are crooked. But they go around and they doctor shop. Well, Medicaid doesn't follow the dispensing of the prescriptions. They can look and see that someone went to a bunch of different doctors, but Medicaid can't track the dispensing of the medication if it is paid for in cash. So what do you think the drug dealers are doing? They're paying for it in cash, and we're not able to track the repetition of those prescription fills. And in doing so, we're losing a lot of opportunity to stop drug dealers from filling their inventory on our dime.
Another point you brought out, you brought a directive from the State Department of Health in regard to how eligibility for Medicaid is determined. And it probably goes beyond the statute as far as I can see. But tell us about what it had said. And I thought that was a big revelation.
Well, it sure was for me. When I was preparing to come and speak before you, I knew what I wanted to tell you about Warren County, but I wanted to have a handle on what was really going on in terms of state policy. And so I was very pleased to have a staff person in my office, Nancy Harrison, work with me, along with Kelly Barker, who is in social services. And Kelly Barker forwarded me two of these directives that blew my mind. The one directive was in November 20th, 2009, which it said, from now on, there's going to be no resource review for a Medicaid application. So you're not entitled to look at a bank account, a 401k, whether they own any real estate, whether they own any vehicles, whether they have any stocks. In Warren County, we have a couple that has an incorporated business. They have a very nice home. They send their child to a private university, and they've applied for Medicaid. Now, all the income is shielded in the corporation, but under the rules as they are promulgated, they're not violating any application process, even though they can afford to pay for their own private insurance. And what was even more disarming was a subsequent memo, January 11, 2010, which had affirmatively instructed the employees of the social services system to minimize investigations.
And that was incredible. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, it's on page 4, the fifth paragraph down. And when I saw it, I thought, this is amazing. It's like the government is asking people to condone fraud. And I find it appalling as a taxpayer. But I'm also a taxpayer.
This is part of what they did in the budget last year. I say they because I did not support it. They minimized all sorts of screenings, re-certifications, investigations into people's assets, and I just don't think it was really appropriate. And at the time,
I think it's reckless.
Yeah,
I think it's financially and morally reckless. And what's very troubling is that we're going bankrupt as a state. We're having to get rid of programs that are viable, and there's not anyone that's even standing up and saying, this is outrageous. Take a look at it.
What structurally can we do? By the way, I was very impressed. You had with you your sheriff, you had a commissioner of social services, you had the director of probation. I mean, you're working as a team If we wanted to legislate that, it would be almost impossible to say, how do you get people together in the same roof? Because that's what every county should have.
I think, exactly. I mean, this isn't brain surgery. Everyone has a different discipline, different skill sets, but we all have the same objective. What we want to do is make Warren County as safe as possible. We want to protect everyone who's entitled to benefits under social services, make sure that they are given every protection under the programs that they're entitled to. But if you are committing a fraud, if you are lying on your application, if you are hiding your assets, we will prosecute you. And that's the message we've sent. We had one case where a drug dealer admitted that he sold drugs, that he had made $2,000 in the drug industry in 1 week, and he was getting welfare. And he not just has a drug charge, but he also has a welfare fraud charge pending against him. And we will go after every case that we find. But the problem is finding them. And that's because there's so many hurdles in getting the information, particularly in the Medicaid fraud arena.
Now, you and DA Rice talked about getting the information out of the Medicaid Inspector General of the state. She made a recommendation that information be freely available to the district attorneys. It seems to me that that is a common sense recommendation.
Well, it's a catch-22. Of course, Kathleen's suggestion is very common sense. And what they say is, we will give you the information if you can say that there is an active investigation going. But we can't say that there's an active investigation going until we can look at the information. And you can cite chapter and verse. You know, Kathleen cited a dentist who bills for more teeth than are in the mouth. And we know that there is that type of fraud going on. It's not, I respect privacy issues. I recognize that we don't want to have Big Brother looking down on us. But we know that there is fraud there, and we know there is no oversight. And we also know that as we go further down in a financial crisis, we're going to have to make very tough decisions about what we can afford and what we can't afford. So I would think that collectively we could, with all common sense collaborating, figure out ways that we can just eradicate fraud. Don't let people get cash on a benefits card.
Well, that was, you also said something about you could tell when there had been some runner of drugs that had come down from the city to Warren County.
The Glens Falls police sergeant at night, John Winchell, is a superstar. And I said to Winch, how did you know the drug dealer had delivered then? He said, well, there's a line at the ATM, Kate.
Oh, and that's how you got to the benefit card.
It's 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
And I said, what do you mean a line at the ATM? They're all unemployed. What are they going? And he said, oh, they get the benefits card. We also had a drug dealer that came up from Schenectady who asked to be put up in temporary housing. So he was placed in a hotel in Lake George. We were paying for his room, his clean sheets every day, his HBO, and we were paying the overhead of the drug dealer because they didn't have the time, the resources, or necessarily the knowledge that they should be looking into those temporary assistance
programs. I presume you don't have a lot of resources yourself in this county.
No, and I'm going to talk to you about that
later.
Well,
no, but I would presume we ought to be putting in, so much like asset forfeiture, that a district attorney involved in a recovery's case should get some type of proceeds for further work in that area.
And it's not about the money. It's about how you spend taxpayer money. It would seem to me that it would make sense to invest some money in investigation and prosecution when we can show millions of dollars that's being defrauded. And I'm using that as a low ball. I don't know if it gets to the billion, but it is tens of millions of dollars. In Warren County alone, on temporary assistance alone, in 1 year, it's $500,000. My county has 63,000 people in it. So imagine what your jurisdition
1.2 million. Yeah.
So extrapolate that out. The numbers get very big very quickly. And I think that
our numbers are up because the time has run out. District Attorney Kate Hogan, thank you very much for joining
with
us.
Thank you, Senator.
Appreciate it. I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. I'll see you again next time. Thank you.